Hello everyone, welcome back to our YouTube channel Guru Mantra Siksha Ka Granth. I am your educator Nidhi Duwa and I warmly welcomes you at this platform. So guys, in today's lecture we are going to start our new topic, that is about equilibrium of section number 4. But before starting this section 4, I would like to tell you the application of Beer-Lambert's law. Okay? So let's begin our today's topic, that is about definition and equation of Beer-Lambert's law. As you know it very well, in previous lecture we have studied about this Beer-Lambert's law. So this Beer-Lambert's law states that quantity of light absorbed by a substance dissolved in a fully transmitting solvent is directly proportional to the concentration of the substance. You have studied in the Beer's law that the absorbance of any substance is directly proportional to the concentration of the substance and the path length of the light through the solution. Okay, so because Beer's law states that, it means by the help of Beer-Lambert's equation we can calculate both the concentration of the solution by using the absorbances, or plot a graph of various concentrations, align them to their correct absorbances. And we can calculate both of these absorbance and the concentration by the help of calorimeter, which can be used to find the concentration of an unknown solution. Now, if we talk about the application of Beer-Lambert's law, this Beer-Lambert's law is applied to the analysis of a mixture by the spectrophotometry. This is a very important term, spectrophotometry, or you can say a very important technique. Okay, so what is spectrophotometry? So spectrophotometry is a method to measure how much a chemical substance absorbs light by measuring the intensity of light as a beam of light passes through the sample solution. The basic principle is that each component absorbs or transmits light over a certain range of wavelength. Generally, it can be used to determine the concentration of a particular substance or to determine the molar absorptivity of a substance. Okay, so this was about the Beer-Lambert's law, and with related to the Beer-Lambert's law, we will do some questions in the practice session. Okay, now our new topic, that is equilibrium. This topic equilibrium is very, very important. In today's lecture, we will study some important points related to the equilibrium. This lecture will just include an overview about the equilibrium. Okay, so before starting the term equilibrium, we should know about the chemical reactions, because in this topic equilibrium we will deal with the some chemical reactions. Okay, so what are the chemical reactions? So chemical reactions are the symbolic representation of any chemical change in terms of reactant and product. Okay, so if we talk about the types of reaction, we have different types of reactions. Number one basis is on the basis of physical state. When we say on the basis of physical state, we have two different kinds of reaction. Number one is homogeneous reaction and number two is heterogeneous reactions. So in homogeneous reactions, all the reactants and products are in the same physical state. Now, what are the physical states? As you know it very well, we have different physical states like solid physical state, liquid physical state and gaseous physical state. So in homogeneous reaction, all the reactant and product are present in the similar kind of phase. For example, we have a reaction for the formation of ammonia. For the formation of ammonia, N2, nitrogen should be present in the gaseous form and hydrogen should be also present in the gaseous form. And when N2 and H2 reacts, this will lead to the formation of ammonia gas. And the product that we are getting is also in the similar phase, that is in the gaseous phase. Next is heterogeneous reaction. So in heterogeneous reactions, reactant and product are in the two or more different phases. Means reactant will be in the different phase and product will be in the different phase. For example, we have Zn, zinc, that is present in solid form. CO2, that is present in the gaseous form. When these two reacts, this will lead to the formation of ZnO plus CO. ZnO is in the solid phase while carbon monoxide is present in the gaseous phase. So this is about the homogeneous and heterogeneous type of reaction. That was totally based on the physical state of the reaction. Next criteria for classifying the reactions, we have on the basis of direction. On the basis of direction, we have two different types of reactions. Number one is reversible reaction and number two is irreversible reactions. So if we talk about reversible reactions are those kinds of chemical reactions in which product can be converted back into the reactant. As you can see here, this double-sided arrow, this dual arrow represents the reversible type of reactions. Means reactant can be converted into product and product can be converted into reactant. So for example, N2 plus 3H2 will react together and leads to the formation of ammonia, and ammonia on giving certain conditions will completely converted back into the reactant. Okay. Similarly, we have 3Fe plus 4H2 that will leads to the formation of Fe3O4 plus 4H2, and this Fe3O4 plus 4H2 when react under the similar conditions will be converted back into the reactants. Okay. So if you talk about reversible reactions, these kinds of reversible reactions can be proceed in forward as well as in the backward directions. As you can see here, this dual-sided arrow represents the reversible reactions, means reaction can be proceed in forward direction as well as in the backward direction also. Now, these kinds of reversible reactions are possible only in the closed containers, and the reactants are never converted completely into the products. Here you have to mention completely. Reactants are never converted completely into the product. Okay. Once again. So here you have to write completely. Next point is about neutralization. If we talk about the neutralization type of reactions, neutralization reaction accept strong acid and strong base. Okay, for example, HCl plus NH4OH will leads to the formation of NH4Cl plus H2O. Next type of reactions we have is irreversible kind of reaction. Irreversible kind of reaction means chemical reaction which proceeds in which products cannot be converted back into the reactant. For example, AgNO3 plus NaCl when react will leads to the formation of AgCl plus NaNO3. But what we have to remember, this single arrow represents the irreversible kind of reaction. In this reaction, this product can never be converted back into the reactant. Okay. Similarly, Zn plus H2SO4 will lead to the formation of ZnSO4 plus H2. But ZnSO4 plus H2 will not react and cannot form the reactant, that is Zn plus H2SO4. This type of irreversible reactions proceeds only in the one direction, that is forward direction. Means reactant can be converted into product, but product cannot be converted back into the reactants. Generally, these kinds of irreversible reactions are possible in the open container. And these kinds of irreversible reactions do not attain any kinds of equilibrium. Reactants are nearly completely converted into products. And this kinds of irreversible type of reaction can occurs neutralization reaction of strong acid and strong base. For example, HCl plus NaOH will lead to the formation of NaCl plus H2O. Next criteria we have on the basis of speed. On the basis of speed, reactions are of two types, fast reactions and slow reactions. So, if you talk about the fast reactions, generally these kinds of fast reactions includes the ionic reactions. For example, HCl, that is acid, reacting with NaOH, that is base, will lead to the formation of a salt of NaCl and water. And you have to remember this point, in fast reactions, we cannot determine the rate. Rate determination is impossible in these kinds of fast reaction. Okay. You have learned in the chemical kinetics topic that if you want to determine the rate of any kind of reaction, any kind of chemical reaction, you have to go through with the slowest step. Okay. Next, we have the slow reactions. So generally these kinds of reaction includes the molecular reactions, and rate determination is possible only in these slow reactions. Okay. Next we have the another criteria, that is based on the heat. On the basis of heat, we have two different kinds of reaction, exothermic reaction and endothermic reaction. If we talk about exothermic reaction, these are the reactions in which heat is required for the reactant to convert it into the product. As you can see here, exothermic reactions are those reactions in which heat is evolved, means heat is liberated. For example, if the reactant is converted into product, then these some kinds of heat is also liberated. As you can see here, reactant is converted into product, then X kilocalorie type of heat is evolved. And change in enthalpy or internal energy should be present, that is in the negative form. So in exothermic reactions, delta H is negative. Second type is endothermic reaction. When you talk about endothermic reaction, in these type of reactions, heat is absorbed. Means to convert the reactant into product, you will require some kind of internal heat. Okay, so reactant plus X kilocalorie of heat will lead to the formation of product. And in endothermic reactions, delta H will be positive. Now, we have two different notes. These two notes are very important while solving the questions. Okay. So note number one says, whenever questioner doesn't ask about the direction, then we have to take the forward direction only. Okay. If in any question you are not giving any kind about the direction, then you have to consider the reaction to be proceed in the forward direction only. Okay. Second note says, in a reversible reaction, if forward reaction is exothermic, then the backward reaction will be automatically endothermic, and vice versa. Means if forward reaction is endothermic, then the backward reaction will be exothermic. Okay. So these are the two important notes that you have to memorize. Now we have types of equilibrium. We have two different types of equilibrium. Number one is physical equilibrium and number two is chemical equilibrium. If you talk about physical equilibrium, this physical equilibrium will include those reactions in which changes only in only the state of substance. Means in physical equilibrium, the state of the substance, the change in the physical state of the substance will be considered. Okay. For example, we have solid liquid equilibrium, or you can say ice water system. In ice water system or solid liquid equilibrium, melting of ice is accompanied by the absorption of heat. Means endothermic reaction will be occur and there will be decrease in the volume. Means when you give some heat, the solid form of ice will convert it into the liquid form water, and this is an example of the physical equilibrium in which there is no chemical change occurring, but the physical state of the substance is changing. In this solid liquid equilibrium, firstly ice is present in the solid form and this ice is converting into the liquid form. Okay, so here only the physical state is changing without getting any change in the chemical reaction. Next we have liquid vapor equilibrium. Liquid vapor equilibrium means water and water vapor system. In this kind of liquid vapor equilibrium, water will be converted into water vapors. Means the water is present in liquid state and water that is present in liquid state will convert it into the water vapor gaseous state. Vaporization of water is an endothermic and condensation of water into vapor is an exothermic process. Means this kind of reaction is your reversible reaction. And the equilibrium shifts right side when the temperature is increased. So temperature will be increased. Temperature will increase the vapors, okay, and the equilibrium will shift towards the left side in case of liquid vapor equilibrium when the pressure is increased and the volume will be decreased. Why the volume will be decreased? Because pressure and volume are always present in the inverse manner. P1 V1 is equals to P2 V2. So increase in pressure will favor the rate of condensation of vapor into water. Next we have solid vapor equilibrium. Solid vapor equilibrium means solid vapor system or the sublimation type of process. This type of physical equilibrium can be established when the solid is sublimed in a closed container. For example, solid iodine sublimes to give the iodine vapor and this iodine vapor will again condense to give the solid iodine. Means this is also an reversible reaction. Next we have the gaseous in liquid in which the solubility of gases can be found. Now we have some important points, general characteristics related to the equilibrium involving the physical processes. So our number one point says equilibrium is possible only in an isolated system, okay, at a given particular temperature, and it is just not possible to reach equilibrium in an open system. To attain the equilibrium condition, we need a closed system. Next we have there is a dynamic but stable condition because both the opposing processes occur simultaneously but at the same rate. Means forward reaction and backward reaction will be occur simultaneously at the same rate. And all the measurable physical properties of the system at any equilibrium position will be constant. And the establishment of the physical equilibrium is always characterized by the constant value of one of the parameters at a given temperature. So this was all about the equilibrium, physical equilibrium. Now in case if you are new here at our YouTube channel, you can like, share and subscribe. If you have any query, you can mail us on tanejanehaofficial@gmail.com or you can also contact us on the 9351280000. Now, a very important announcement. If you are preparing for CSIR UGC NET, you can follow Neha Taneja ma'am on an academy platform. On an academy platform, you will get daily live classes, structural courses, live test and quizzes, and with one subscription, you will get unlimited access. If you are interested, you can go through with this detailed paid classes. While taking these detailed paid classes, you can use referral code Neha, that is NEHA, and after using this referral code, you will get 10% discount on total fee. Thank you very much guys. I hope now you all are cleared about the today's lecture.